Good evening and welcome to the Redwood Library and Athenaeum. I'm Patricia Pettit, the Communications Officer here at the Redwood, and we're delighted you're joining us again. This is a special evening because Dr. Marquardt has agreed to have another year of his music appreciation series. So it's a very celebratory time that we have 12 more wonderful lectures ahead of us. Tonight we're going to be exploring the world of Mozart's operas. And Dr. Marquardt is starting with the DuPonte operas. This is going to be part one. So we're delighted he's back. And join me in welcoming Dr. Marquardt.
Thank you, Patricia. Good evening, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to embark on a trilogy of talks about the three operas by Mozart with libretti by Lorenzo da Ponte. They are The Marriage of Figaro, or Le Nozze di Figaro, ou Le Mariage de Figaro, The Marriage of Figaro, or A Mad Day, which was taken from a play by Pierre Beaumarchais, which he wrote in 1784. Marriage of Figaro was composed largely in 1786. Don Giovanni is the next in 1787, or Il Dissoluto Punito, ossia Il Don Giovanni, The Punishment of the Dissolute One, or Don Giovanni. And that, of course, follows the legend of Don Juan. The last one was totally made up by Da Ponte and Mozart, and that is Così fan tutte, or The School for Lovers, which was 1790. These three operas are the most popular of Mozart's operas, with the exception possibly of The Abduction from the Seraglio and The Magic Flute. Both of those are in the Singspiel genre, which means they have spoken words and are in German. These three operas were created for the court in Vienna, and they are all in Italian, which was the popular way of doing opera in those days, no matter what country you were in. They are all in the genre also of opera buffa, or comic opera, except that Mozart hedges his bet a little bit in Don Giovanni and entitles it a dramma giocoso, or a joyful drama. And the same is true of Così fan tutte. He calls that also a dramma giocoso. All three have an urgency of story. I'm not sure that the public generally realizes this, but in all three operas, the action takes place in the course of only one day. And despite the light and comic opera character implied, there's an aspiration of freedom inspired by the Age of Enlightenment. And it deals with themes which were sort of daring for their time. Audiences clamored to hear these themes, and some, as The Marriage of Figaro by Beaumarchais, were prohibited from being performed in Vienna at the time. Da Ponte rearranged the libretto so that it passed the censors for The Marriage of Figaro. Marriage of Figaro deals with politics, and more so of that in the play than in the opera, religion in Don Giovanni, and morality in Così, specifically infidelity. Other topics in these three operas are the search for love or sexual pleasure, the disguise ensuing in mistaken identities that occurs in all three operas, the harassment of women by men. Mozart addresses this in all three operas, again, the misogynistic viewpoint of men, and especially the conflicts between the upper class and the servants. The play Figaro had caused a sensation when it was written at a time of revolution. Of course, it was able to be performed in France, if not Vienna. And its subject matter of servants rising up and outwitting their masters outrage the aristocracy. A bit about Da Ponte. I think we all know quite a bit about Mozart, but about Lorenzo Da Ponte, who was born 1749 in Venice, and he died in 1838 in New York City. He was born Emanuele Conegliano in the Republic of Venice. He was Jewish by birth, and he took his new name of Lorenzo da Ponte from the priest who baptized him. He took the orders of the priesthood, but he also took a mistress and had two children. He was tried in court for living with a concubine and having entertainment in a bordello. He was banned from Venice for 15 years. He moved to Vienna, and as luck would have it, he had a letter of introduction to Antonio Salieri, whom you all may remember from Amadeus, the great composer, who was Mozart's chief rival. When he arrived, Salieri was the big guy in Vienna, not Mozart. And da Ponte, of course, latched on to Salieri. He also wrote libretti for Soler, and Mozart sought him out and convinced him to do the Beaumarchais play. A little bit about him after he went bankrupt. Well, he did these three operas for Mozart and then moved first to New York, then to Pennsylvania, back to New York, where he opened a bookstore. He was the first teacher of Italian at Columbia University, then Columbia College. He started an opera company known as the New York Repertory Company, which was the forerunner of the New York Academy of Music, which Dvorak later headed, and the forerunner of the Metropolitan Opera. He died in August of 1838 in New York, and thousands attended his funeral at St. Patrick's Cathedral. Let's talk a bit more about the commonality and characteristics of the trilogy. Verdi coined a term called parola scenica, or scenic utterance, and it was used for unity in his work. The text becomes drama, and then the drama is reflected in the music. Mozart and da Ponte anticipate this. If you look at the scores of Mozart, the dynamics, louds and softs and so on, and any expressive marks, of which there are very few, are totally in the orchestra parts. So the singers have to pay attention to what the orchestra is doing to know whether to sing loudly or softly. Also, conversely, it's up to the conductor or the performers to put the inflections of the words into the orchestra parts before rehearsal. Mozart also invented the finale, where anywhere from 3 to 6 to 8 to 10 performers all have their ideas going at once, and it's the miracle of Mozart that gets them all together in one musical entity in the finale of each act. The second act of The Marriage of Figaro runs from 18 to 20 minutes, and 8 of the 11 characters in the opera are involved, and it is the longest single total running set of music that Mozart ever composed without stop. The connections both in the music and the text, there's jealousy and suspicion. In Figaro, Count Almaviva discovers Cherubino hiding in Susanna's room. Don Basilio, Susanna's singing teacher, sings, and this is a Figaro, "Così fan tutte le belle, non c'è alcuna novità." All women do that. There's nothing new about it. And out of that phrase, Mozart and da Ponte are able to come up with their third opera. All three operas also deal with masks and disguises and different identification. Cherubino's disguise in Susanna is sort of interesting. Cherubino is what we call a pants role. It is a young 14-year-old boy being played by a woman, and in one scene disguised as a woman. Guglielmo and Ferrando's disguises in Così, where they disguise themselves as Albanians to try to woo each other's fiancés. And then there are several points in Don Giovanni, and most implicitly when Leporello and Giovanni trade places. More about that in the ensuing months as we look into these three operas. All three have promises of lovers to be faithful at all times. Those vows are always broken. And for the most part, all is good at the end. The conflict in the religious part of Don Giovanni is his roguishness, his philandering, and Donna Anna's earthly righteousness. Other things are bad guys are generally men of action. In the first, it's Count Almaviva. In the second, it's Don Giovanni. And in the third, it's Ferrando Guglielmo, and especially Don Alfonso. There have been productions, festivals, sort of, in which directors, stage directors, have tried to tie these three operas into a real trilogy. And one of the ways they do that is having the characters played by the same actors or singers throughout. For instance, the Count Almaviva, who's a bad guy, basically, in Marriage of Figaro, is next heard as Don Giovanni in that opera, and then as Don Alfonso in the last. Excuse me. And there's always a comeuppance at the ends of these operas. There's a matter-of-fact approach by the populace at the time to the moral issues. In Figaro, the main issue is the right of first night. Count Almaviva, the lord of the manor, has always had the first right to the woman whom any servant is marrying. And that is the gist of what is going to happen in the Marriage of Figaro. I've always felt that there is a bite in Mozart's humor, and I've found through 50 years of dealing with Mozart's music, which is, to me, among the greatest ever written, when he writes happy music, if you look behind all those notes, there's usually a tear someplace. It's almost Chaplin-esque in its approach, and that is found in these all three of these operas, I think. We're going to get to the Marriage of Figaro here right now, and as I said, it's the second of the trilogy, after the Barber of Seville and before the Guilty Wife, also known as the Other Tartuffe. I want to read to you about the political things that were left out of the opera, but which can be found, if I can find these things, in the play itself, because it shows why, perhaps, the play was banned. Well, when I find it, I'll read it to you, I guess. The servants, Figaro, succeed in getting married finally at the end of this opera. The whole point is to prevent that from happening by the Count. And he goes to all sorts of shenanigans to prevent that marriage. The tables are turned, of course. Figaro, Susanna, and the Countess all come up with a plot. And it works out that he is totally embarrassed. He begs forgiveness. And the Countess, being the wonderful person that she is, does forgive him at the end, and everybody goes off, drinks beer and whatever. Let's now listen to the first part of this opera, which really sets it up. It's the overture. It's probably one of the most famous overtures ever written, the overture to the Marriage of Figaro. The K number, in case you're interested, is 492. And I want you to keep in mind throughout how fast this overture is. Thank you. And then we have what's known as the recapitulation. The overture is very short, 4 minutes long. It's in sonata allegro form, which means we have an A section, a B section, somewhat of a small development, and then it's repeated in the home key. Interestingly, in this opera, as opposed to the other two, not one phrase is found in the opera itself. So the overture is a standalone overture. The characters in this opera are the same as we found in the earlier Barber of Seville or the later Barber of Seville. There's the Count Almaviva, a baritone, whom you may remember as Lindoro, who is trying to marry Rosina in the Barber of Seville. He's the governor of Andalusia, and the Count is made hypocritical and unaware of his wealth and status, feeling entitled to do whatsoever he pleases. He's not the youthful, young, idealistic man he was in the first. The Countess of Almaviva is Rosina, who was in the first, the Barber of Seville. Susanna is the maid to the Countess, Figaro the servant to the Count. Cherubino is a page boy, and as I mentioned, it's a pants role. Marcellina is interesting. In the earlier opera, Figaro had promised to marry her in exchange for the cancellation of a debt. However, at the end of this opera, we find out that she is her and Dr. Bartolo's long-lost son. Dr. Bartolo was former Rosina's guardian in the earlier opera, seeks revenge against Figaro for thwarting his plans to marry Rosina. Don Basilio, you remember, was Rosina's music teacher. He is a tenor in this opera. And then there are several other characters, as well as a chorus of peasants and the counts. And I found what I was looking for. Toward the end of the play, both Figaro and Marcellina have their say, and you can, I think you'll be able to tell why Da Ponte and Mozart left it out of the opera. It's because of statements like you're about to hear that the play by Beaumarchais was banned. Figaro says to the Count, "Because you are a great nobleman, you think you are a great genius. What have you done to deserve such advantages? Put yourself to the trouble of being born, nothing more. For the rest, a very ordinary man, whereas I, lost among the obscure crowd, have had to deploy more knowledge, more calculation, and skill merely to survive than has sufficed to rule all the province of Spain for a century. Yet you would measure yourself against me." That speech is left out of the opera, so the opera was able to go for 9 performances in Vienna, and then it was moved to Prague, where it became a great hit, many, many performances. And while in Prague, Mozart was encouraged to write Don Giovanni. Marcellina complains about the status of women. I believe, as I told you, there's the misogynistic element in all three of these operas. There's also a class distinction as well as an equality between female and male. Marcellina complains about the status of women. In a state of servitude behind the alluring pretenses of respect, treated as children where our possessions are concerned, we are punished as responsible adults where our faults are in question. Moving on with the marriage of Figaro, in the first scene, we find Figaro and Susanna together in the room which will become their bridal bower. Figaro is measuring, and you will be able to hear that, 5, 10, 5, 10, and he goes through the measurements with the ruler, trying to measure the room to see how the bed will fit. Susanna is trying on a new bonnet and asks Figaro time and time again, "Please look, what do you think of my new bonnet?" She's standing in front of a mirror. In a part that we're going to have to skip because it's a bit longish, they worry that the room is too close to the Count's quarters. And remember the rite of first night. It's a big concern of theirs. Also, she wonders how the Countess will summon her to do her duties, and they come up with the device of a bell. In this scene, Susanna tells Figaro that the Count wants to reinstate the first night rite. Here they are, measuring the room and trying on bonnets. I should tell you that the cast in this is quite extraordinary. It's the BBC Symphony Orchestra, conducted by the late Sir Colin Davis, one of the great Mozart interpreters of our time. The Count is Ingvar Wicksell. The Contessa, the Countess, is Jessie Norman. Susanna is Mirella Freni. Figaro is Vladimir Gozzarola. Cherubino is Ivan Minton. And the Basilio is Robert Teer. Just a tremendous cast. As I said, Susanna spills the beans to Figaro that the Count wants to reinstate first night rite. The Count's plan is now to go to London, and Figaro will be his valet, and Susanna will go along also as the ambassadress in secret. This is Se vuol ballare, signor Contino, in which Figaro, you can tell from the first bit we heard him there with Susanna, they're all happy, and it's a very light, lovely duet. There's some anger, sarcasm, and pain as Figaro sings his cavatina, Se vuol ballare. If you would dance, Sir Count, I'll play the tune on my guitar. If you will come to my dancing school, I'll gladly teach you the capriole. I know how, but soft, every dark secret I'll discover better by pretending, sharpening my skill and using it pricking with this one, playing with that one, all of your schemes I'll turn inside out. Different voice now, filled with a bit of menace. Every dark secret I'll discover, piano, piano, piano. The second part of the cavatina is faster. And then the repeat of the Se vuol ballare, or the A section of the aria. As those of you who know this opera know that I'm skipping around a bit, trying to hit some of the highlights and still keep a thread of the plot going. Next, we are going to hear Cherubino, the page, 14 years old, who is on a hormonal mission throughout this opera. And you will hear the breathlessness that Mozart has built into this aria. Cherubino has composed a song and asks Susanna to give it to the Countess. And then she says, give it to Barbarina. Why don't you just give it to every woman in the castle? I no longer know what I am. Non so più cosa son cosa faccio. I no longer know what I am, what I do. Now I'm all fire, now all ice. Every woman changes my temperature. Every woman makes my heart beat faster. The very mention of love, of delight, disturbs me, changes my heart. And speaking of love, forces on me a desire I cannot restrain. Junior high stuff. Thank you. And it goes on. And in many of these arias, you hear the urgency, or in this case, the breathlessness. I think I would like to go back and play just a little bit more of the beginning of this. So you can hear in the violas and second violins, ba-da-da-ba-da-da-ba-da-da-ba-da-da, the orchestration contributes to the breathlessness. It's a little bit hard to hear, but I have the music here and it's there, I promise you. Now comes the first real ensemble singing in the opera. It's a trio with the Count, Susanna, and Don Basilio. And what has happened is the Count comes storming in and thinks he spies Cherubino, whom Susanna has hid behind a chair. The Count suspects Cherubino of trying to sleep with every woman in the castle, and so he wants to throw the kid out. What I want you to hear, I would like you to hear two things, but one's rather impossible. The first is that every character is exceedingly well defined. You can tell who's singing. What will help is if you know that Basilio is a tenor, the Count is a baritone, and Susanna, of course, is a soprano. In the midst of this trio, once again, Mozart and da Ponte draw on the libretto that they will, or on the words that they will use two operas hence, when Basilio utters the phrase, "Così fan tutte le belle, non c'è alcuna novità." All pretty women are the same. There's nothing new in this case. Tremendous orchestration. Notice how the voices match the dynamics that Mozart indeed put in the orchestra. Etc. The Count now decides that one way to get rid of Cherubino was to have him join the army. And so, as I mentioned earlier, sometimes the music is more truthful than the words, or the words tell the story and the music sort of gets in the way. In this case, Figaro is telling Cherubino what a grand time he's going to have in the army. No more will you, amorous butterfly, flit around the castle night and day, upsetting all the pretty girls, love's little Narcissus and Adonis, etc. No more will you have those fine plumes, that soft and stylish hat, those fine locks, that striking air, those rosy girl-like cheeks, etc. You're going to be marching through mud and ducking shells. This is probably one of the more famous arias from this opera, Non più andrai farfallone amoroso.
Non più andrai farfallone amoroso, notte e giorno di giorno tirando, le belle del mondo riposo, ci sento ad anzio d'amore. Le belle del mondo riposo, non ti avrai questi bei pettacchini, quel cappello leggero e galante, quella chioma bell'aria che durante, il vermiglio con questo colore, il vermiglio con questo colore.
That repeats, but toward the end you can hear very military music. And that is the end of Act One. And the trumpet players can now go back to sleep because that's when the only time they play. Act Two begins with one of Mozart's, I think, greatest largo or slow creations. The Countess has not appeared. And this is one of the great entrances in all of opera. This is the great Porgi Amor Qualche Ristoro. It's a cavatina sung by the Countess as she comes out. And here's a great example of a major key with tears all over. She's regal, she's above the fray, she's brave, she has integrity, she's steadfast. And note the warmth as we listen to this of the clarinets. John Ruggiano, Dr. John, you can listen to the clarinets, you probably know they're coming. 4 years later, Mozart again creates one of his greatest slow movements, and that is the middle movement of the great clarinet concerto, one of the last pieces he wrote. The Countess does indeed know of her husband's philandering, and she sings, "Grant, love, some relief to my mourning, to my sighing, give me back my treasure, or at least let me die." And that is the sole substance of the text, and Mozart lets the music speak. A motto aria, meaning the orchestra plays the vocal theme before the singer enters.
Mm-hmm.
I've never figured out, as long as I've been conducting pieces like this, how the singers get through them. Because in the pit, as a conductor, I feel I almost crack up and start crying on the spot. Moving along, that's in Act 2. We now come to Act 3. And the Count, in his cavatina, first with a little bit of an accompanied recitative, without just harpsichord, we now have motives, themes, phrases that are interspersed with the singer from the orchestra. It's called recitativo accompagnato. And this is "I già vinto la causa." The case is won, says the Count. Whoa, wait a minute. What's that? What trap have I fallen into? And then in his aria, he sings, "Vedrò mentr'io sospiro, felice il servo mio, e un benché in van desio e posseder dovrà. Shall I live to see a servant of mine happy," that being Figaro, "and enjoying pleasure that I desire in vain?" And of course, referring to Susanna. Whoops. Sorry, it skips around sometimes. Big orchestra accompaniment. Next, I would like to show, well, I consider that part A, crux of the opera. It turns a corner here, and we're in Act 3, and I feel that the next recitative and aria by the Countess is crux part B. This is a prototypical aria, preceded by a recitative, but a prototypical aria by Mozart, and then it has a rather slow and pensive cavatina followed by a rather fast cabaletta. And there's a parallel aria in Così fan tutte, which we'll explore down the road, called Come scoglio, like a rock. Fiordiligi sings that, and it's the same kind of sentiment from both of these ladies, the Contessa and Fiordiligi, in that they are both solid, steadfast in their love for their partners. This is Dove Sono. It begins, E Susanna non viene. She's waiting for Susanna to show up. And then she sings this marvelous aria, Dove Sono? Where are the golden moments of tranquility and pleasure? What became of the oaths of that deceitful tongue, in which she refers, of course, to the Count? And then her resolve, she stiffens, her back stiffens, and she sings, Ah, si almen la mia Costanza. Ah, if then my constancy still loves through its sorrow. And she is filled with resolve. There's a B section and then the repeat, and let's go to the allegro. The end of the repeat of the A section. Thank you. Generally brings the house down. I think this afternoon, I may not get out of this room alive, but I had the great pleasure of watching a video of Diana McVeigh performing this aria in a performance, on stage performance from the Florentine Opera in Milwaukee. I wish I could share it, but I couldn't figure out how to get it from video to what we do here now. One thing I would like to point out that may or may not be of interest to anybody other than myself, that all of Mozart's tempi in other genres, whether they are string quartets, whether they are piano sonatas, concerti for violin or piano, or the great 41 symphonies, the tempi all come out of his position as an opera composer, of which he was par excellence, of course. If we have an allegro in, just for an example, in an aria, Mozart, as other good composers, based that tempo on the singer's ability to sing either the fast notes or how much can be done in one breath. In the case of slower pieces like Porta di Amor, how slow can the singer go and make the phrase meaningful in one breath? And so we apply these tempi to the other genres in which Mozart excelled, to symphonies and so on. A study was done about 25 years ago by a French musicologist by the name of Marty, unfortunately I've forgotten his first name, in which he mapped out every tempo marking or expressive marking, if that's the way you want to look at it, allegro, presto, largo, and coordinated it with a part of an aria or an introduction to an aria, and put these in every other piece that Mozart wrote. And it's really instructive. It takes a while to get through, but it's very, very meaningful. And I think when orchestras play with a sense of singing, which of course Toscanini was always yelling, canto, 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 I think it makes for the great orchestras like the Berlin Philharmonic, the Orchestra of Santa Cecilia Academy in Rome, etc. Let us move on to the finale. And the finale actually is about 15 minutes long. But we're going to jump in toward the end. And I'm going to stop right before the fastest part and refresh our memories as to how fast the overture went. And here is the tying all ends together, because the music is similar, if not the same, and it's the same tempo. Susanna disguised as the Countess disguised as Susanna. Cherubino tries to seduce the disguised Countess. The Count arrives looking for Susanna. He chases the boy away. The Count returns to discover Figaro with his wife, or so he thinks, and explodes with rage. At that moment, and you'll hear it clearly, the real Countess steps forward and reveals her identity. Ashamed, the Count asks her pardon. Ultimately, being the person she is, she forgives him. And of course, the entire household celebrates the day's happy ending. Forgiveness. Thank you, everybody. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. September 13th, it will be Don Giovanni. Thank you all for coming.